All right, good morning. We're going to start our song service off with page 329. There is power in the blood.
Amen.
It's the other side.
Adam wrote up on.
For the blood of Jesus Christ this morning. They talk about us having a slaughterhouse religion, always talking about the blood. But let me tell you, friend, you'll go to hell without it. Because of the blood of Jesus Christ, God has made a way for us to be redeemed and to make a way for us to spend eternity in glory with Him. I'm so thankful for the blood of Jesus. I just start preaching now, folks. I'm so glad you're here this morning. It's great to see all of you. On this beautiful day, weather's a little different than last Sunday. We had to paddle in last Sunday. We're looking for the sunscreen today. But we're just so glad that you've come to be a part of worshiping and celebrating Jesus this morning here at Sardis Baptist Church. If you would take your bulletins out, I have some prayer requests and some updates that I want our church family to be aware of so that we can be praying and encouraging these people this week. We want to be in prayer for Miss Melody and for the Kelton family. Earlier this week, God called Suzette home. The visitation is today at 4 o'clock at O.T. Allen's in Alto, and the funeral service is tomorrow at 2. Did I get that right, Miss Emily? Got that right. So just be in prayer for them, for Eric, for Melody, for their family. And then we've also added the McCloskey family. Rob and Charlene are dear friends of my mom and dad's. We've known them for years. And Miss Charlene was a faithful member of our online congregation. She would watch every week, and she was always so encouraging. And yesterday, God called her home. So I want to be in prayer for Rob, her husband, and for that family. Want to be in prayer for Mr. Tommy. He's Ford. He's been having some health problems this week. Been in the hospital a couple of times. A lot of pain. Hadn't slept a whole lot. Trying to figure out what's going on with him. So we want to be in prayer for Tommy Ford, and also for Ronnie McBride. He's battling in the late stages of cancer. He's not doing very well. Be in prayer for Aaron and for their family in these days. Just a lot of heartache, a lot of sorrow, a lot of difficulties as we walk through this life. But let me tell you what, we have a God that cares. We have a God that's able to heal. We have a God that's able to strengthen, and a God that's able to overwhelm with peace. And we just come and petition Him this morning to intervene in each of these lives in a supernatural way. So we want to be in prayer for them. As far as announcements, the ladies' Bible study will be starting very soon. The Bible study is going to be women in the Bible. As soon as materials come in, they've been ordered. So,
and I've got an email that everything's shipped.
Got an email that they've shipped. So,
we're looking at
supply chain. If the enemy has his way, they'll be stuck in a boat. But we're going to get them here.
15th, if that's...
She said if they come in, that's looking to start around the 15th. And we're also in the process of putting a men's Bible study together as well. It'll be here at the church, and we'll have them on Wednesday evenings. Just going to be a great time of getting in God's Word and to just growing in our faith. In these last days, I can't tell you how important it's going to be for men and women of God to be together in prayer, studying the Word, so that we can take the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ out there. It'll encourage us, it'll encourage you, and I just urge you to be a part of it. Let's go to the Lord in prayer, and then we'll continue our worship service this morning. Heavenly Father, we just come to you today in the mighty name of Jesus. And God, we thank you for the blood that he shed on Calvary so that we could be free from the burden of sin. And God, I just pray that as we go into our worship, as we continue to worship, that you'll be exalted, you'll be glorified, you'll be lifted up. Father, I pray for these families that have lost loved ones, Father. And God, I just ask you to put a hedge of protection around them. I pray that you'll overwhelm them with your peace, with your comfort. Father, that you will just strengthen them in the days ahead. God, I lift Tommy Ford to you this morning. And Father, I just pray for a touch from you, Father, that you will strengthen him, that you'll give him rest. Father, that they will find his problems, Lord, and God, that they'll be easily remedied. Use his doctors. Give them wisdom, Father. And God, we just lift Ronnie McWright to you, Father. And God, just pray that you will strengthen him today. God, be with Aaron. Be with their family, Father. And God, just as he's struggling and as his health is failing, Father, God, we just pray that you will just give peace and comfort everything that they need in this time, Father. And God, be with Melody, be with the Kelton family, Father, and just ask you to bless them today as well. And God, we just pray that as we move and continue to worship, be exalted, Father. It's all about you, and we celebrate you. In Jesus' name, amen.
And don't let Mick fool you. It is still cold outside. The sun's out there, but it's still cold.
Beautiful.
Okay, we're going to continue our song service with page 691, Surely Goodness and Mercy.
Thank you.
continue singing with page 430, There Shall Be Showers of Blessings.
Jesus Messiah, Lord of all. Woo. Thank you, thank you. If you would please open your Bibles with me this morning to the Old Testament book of Joshua, chapter 14. Joshua chapter 14. I'm going to begin reading in verse 10 through verse 15 of Joshua chapter 14. And if you would, out of reverence to the reading of God's word, would you please stand? Joshua chapter 14, beginning in verse 10. And now, behold, the Lord has kept me alive, as he said, these 45 years, ever since the Lord spoke this word to Moses, while Israel wandered in the wilderness. And now, here I am this day, 85 years old. As yet I am as strong this day as on the day that Moses sent me. Just as my strength was then, so now is my strength for war, both for going out and for coming in. Now therefore, give me this mountain, of which the Lord spoke in that day. For you heard in that day how the Anakim were there, and that the cities were great and fortified. It may be that the Lord will be with me, and I shall be able to drive them out, as the Lord said. And Joshua blessed him and gave Hebron to Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, as an inheritance. Hebron, therefore, became the inheritance of Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, the Kenizzite, to this day, because he wholly followed the Lord God of Israel. And the name of Hebron formerly was Kirjath Arba. Arba was the greatest man among the Anakim. Then the land had rest from war. Heavenly Father, I just come to you this morning in the mighty name of Jesus. And God, I just praise you for the privilege that we have to come into your house. I thank you for your word, the Bible. And Father, I just pray that as we look at these events in the life of Joshua and Caleb, Father, God, that we will be motivated and inspired, Father, to wholly submit to you, Father. And God, that I pray that each one of us have mountains that we're facing, mountains that we're climbing, Father. God, I just pray that you will give us strength today in the climb. And God, I just ask that you will bind Satan and his demonic forces from our midst. Father, I rebuke and reject him in Jesus' name. I pray that you will keep distractions to a minimum. And Father, I just pray that you will empower and embolden and anoint me with your Holy Spirit to preach this message. Father, put your words in my head, put your thoughts in my mouth, Father, and be glorified through the preaching of your word. Father, we live in dangerous days, Father, but you are sovereign. You are God, and we come to celebrate you today. Father, be glorified through the preaching. I ask in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. When we get to the accounts in Joshua chapter 14, some incredible things have happened in the life of the tribe of Israel. At this point, they had already been through the promised land. They had crossed over. And we come to the moment when Joshua, who had taken over leadership from Moses when he died, is going to begin to dole out or divide the promised land amongst the 12 tribes. And as he's doing this, as this process is about to unfold, a man by the name of Caleb makes a very bold request of Joshua. The way that it was set up or structured, the land was to be divided equally amongst the tribes, and they were to cast lots for which portion of the land each tribe would obtain. But before this took place, Caleb walked in and he made a very bold request of Joshua. He told Joshua that he wanted a particular mountain. He told Joshua that he had been promised that by God and that it was not to be included in the allotments that were going to be given to everybody else. And as I begin to look at this morning, I'm going to be preaching on the subject, claiming the mountain. Claiming the mountain. This is not some sermon about name it and claim it, because in order to claim a mountain, that means that we have to conquer the mountain and we have to go get it. That means that there are going to be trials. There's going to be things that we have to overcome to get to the top of our mountain. Every single one of us have mountains that we face. Every single one of us have things that we're working through that are challenging to us that we want to get to the top of or to the other side of. And I can tell you today that the only way that you can claim and climb that mountain is through the power of Almighty God. And so we see here that Caleb came and he made a very bold request of Joshua. The Bible says there in verse 10, it says, "And now." We have to understand who Caleb was. There was a moment, an event that took place in biblical history when the children of Israel had arrived at the edge of Canaan. They had arrived at the edge of the promised land. And so Moses had chosen 12 spies to go into the promised land to check it out and to come back and to give a report of what was in the land. And if you recall from earlier in the Bible, that 10 of the spies that came back gave a very unfavorable report. They said, "Oh, it's a land filled with giants. It's a land filled with armies, with cities, with places that are going to be incredibly difficult to take over." And as a result of them, the Bible says that the hearts of the people were melted. They were used by the enemy to instill fear into the children of Israel, trying to convince them just to kind of stay where they were, wandering in the wilderness. And I begin to think that, you know, the enemy does that to us today. There are places, there are mountains that God wants to take us to the top of, but the enemy is always throwing things in our path and throwing boulders at us, bringing storms into our life to try to put fear to keep us from climbing to the top of the mountain. because I begin to think about where did Moses go and meet with God? It was always up on a mountaintop. And that's where, as we walk through this life, there are going to be mountains that we encounter that we want to get to the top of, that we want to get to the other side of. And I'm here to tell you today that when we take the same approach that Caleb had, that we can be victorious in climbing those mountains. He had got to the point, he said, Josh, I want my land. He said that when he came back, he said there were only two spies that came back and gave a favorable report. And it was Caleb and Joshua, the one that he was speaking to in this conversation. The two of them came back and said, you know what? Yeah, it's a land filled with giants. But you know what? Our God is bigger than giants. We serve a God that is able, that is bigger. And the Bible says that Caleb wholly followed God with his whole heart. And in doing so, he had incredible confidence in who God is. And he knew that they could be victorious and that they could take the land because of who their God is. But yet the other 10 did not. As I prepared this week, it made me realize that the number of people that are willing to be bold and courageous for their faith and to step out for the kingdom of God are severely outnumbered. Here in this case, it was 10 to 2. But as a result of that, some very interesting things happened in the life of Caleb. Look at what the Bible says. It says, and now, behold, the Lord has kept me alive. That was a very important statement. Because you have to remember what happened to the rest of the children of Israel. All of those that doubted, all of that generation that he came into, that he wandered in the wilderness with, they all died. So at this moment, Caleb is the oldest member of the tribe of Israel. He's the last one standing, him and Joshua. The rest of that generation had died off, so they were just surrounded by a bunch of youngins that were probably in their 40s by that time. Because those old ones that come in that had fear, that didn't believe that God was able to deliver them, God had taken them out. And so here he says that God had kept me alive because of his faithfulness, that God had sustained his life, and because of a promise that God had made to him. He says that he's kept me alive, as he said, these 45 years. So I began to think, why Caleb? Why Caleb? Why was he the one that came back with a bold report saying that we can take the land? Why was he the one that was so wholly sold out to God? And the answer is found back in the book of Numbers, chapter 14, in verse 24. The Bible says, but my servant Caleb, this is God speaking, because he has a different spirit in him and has followed me fully, I will bring into the land where he went, and his descendants shall inherit it. So God himself promised Caleb that he would inherit that land. And the reason was because he had a different spirit. And I begin to think, what was so different about his spirit? And the answer is simple. He wholly, fully trusted God. And I begin to look and examine in my own life, what are some areas in my life where I don't fully and wholly trust God? You know, what are the things that I hold back? What are the things that I try to do in my own strength or do myself rather than wholly, fully trusting God? Because when we wholly trust God, when we fully trust him in all things, he promises significant blessing. And in this case, he had promised Caleb that because of his obedience and his faithfulness, that he would inherit that land. And that meant that he would have to be old enough and around to see it. And so here Caleb is in that day. You know, he had been wandering in the wilderness. He had been going through all those things. And now the promise that God had made him is about to come to fruition. There are things that God has promised each and every one of you. And let me tell you what, if you remain faithful, they will come to fruition. God will never back up on his promises. If he says he's going to do something, it is already done. It is a fact. And so here Caleb is receiving the blessing that comes from him being fully and wholly sold out to God. He goes on there. He says, he's kept me alive these 45 years, even since the Lord spoke this word to Moses while Israel wandered. You notice in that moment, he separated himself from Israel. The reason they wandered in the wilderness is because they didn't wholly follow after God. The reason that God had to allow them to wander around for that long was because they didn't trust and fully have their faith in God. But Caleb did. But I found it very interesting that even though Caleb was so sold out to God, even though he wholly trusted God with everything, he still had to go through the wandering with all the other people. That he still had to wander and be in the wilderness for those 40 years with everybody. And I begin to think about, you know, in the Christian life today, that we still wander through life. We still are surrounded by people that are wandering through life. And we're still in the midst of them, even when we're striving to remain faithful. And it's okay. Because what Caleb was trying to do, he was trying to be an example for those people. He's the one that came out and said, we don't have to wander anymore. If they had gone in and conquered the promised land at that moment when Caleb said, they would already be there and they wouldn't have had to have wandered because they would have trusted God and believed his promise. God promised that they were going to get the land. But yet when they allowed fear to creep into their heart, it began to take that from them. And so here Caleb, he's standing up, he's saying, I remember that. He said, but I still had to wander. He said, but God made me that promise while Israel wandered in the wilderness, and now, here I am. I love that. Here I am. In that moment, I can imagine the tone of his voice as he spoke that. Because in that, there would have been a sound of confidence in his voice. There would have been a tone of completion in his voice. There would have been a tone of, look what God did. He is faithful because here I am. There is deliverance. God will allow us to the top of the mountain. He will allow us to get to the other side. He will allow us to get through the battles, the difficulties, and the struggles that we face in this life if we'll wholly submit to him and trust him in all things. There are people in this room that God's made promises to you, and there's some things in your life that God wants to do in your life, and you know it. Wholly trust him, fully trust him. He'll see you to the top of the mountain, and you'll be able to stand there when it all takes place and go, whoo, here I am. Look what God did for me. Because in that moment, who was getting all the glory? It was God. He was reminding Joshua of the promises that God had made. God was getting the glory for it. Caleb was like, I'm just here. All I did was be faithful, and look where God has me now. Test him this week. Live wholly surrendered in every part of your life to God and see where he doesn't have you this time next week. God wants to do incredible and amazing things in our life, but we allow fear to come in and to cause us to be ineffective for the kingdom. We allow the circumstances and the busyness of life to get in the way of what God's wanting to do through us. But Caleb didn't allow that to happen. He went full bore, 100% forward for the kingdom of God. And as a result of that, there he stood, the oldest man in the tribe of Israel, about to be given the promise, about to be the receive the fulfillment of the promise that God had made to him. What an incredible time for him. He also, he realized that the reason he was there, that he was still alive, he was 85 years old, was because God is the one that gives life. God is the giver of life. If God promises you he's going to do something in your life, if you're faithful, he's going to allow you to be around to see it fulfilled. All the times in my life when I'm thought, God, you need to work in this area. There's something that you promised me you're going to do this. And you just faithfully trust him. You believe in his word. And then one day you're standing there going, wow, look what God did. My beautiful bride. She's a prayer warrior, folks. She has a prayer closet. She has a war room. And we were sitting in the living room a couple days ago, and there were some papers out of a legal pad. And it had a bunch of names on it. And many of your names were on it, by the way. And it was specific things that she was praying for people, for family, for friends, for our church family. And the list she made was over a year old. And she pulled it out, and she said, I want you to look at this. Look at what God has brought them through. Look at where God has answered this prayer. Look how he answered that one. She was having one of those Caleb moments, you know, as she turned all those things over to God and she raised them before him in prayer. And amazing how many things he answered. And answered the way that we requested. Just thing after thing after thing. And now Caleb, as he's standing here, he's just basking in the glory of God that, you know what, he's faithful and true to his word. He told me I was going to inherit this land, and here I am. I'm 85 years old now, but the promise is going to be fulfilled. Don't give up. If God's promised something in His Word to you, and you've claimed that promise because He showed it to you through Scripture, and He's bared witness with that in your spirit, don't give up. Don't think it's not going to happen. It's going to happen in His perfect timing. If this would have happened 20 years prior, Caleb wouldn't have appreciated as much as he did. If God had delivered you from a circumstance sooner than, you know, because we want it gone right then. If God delivered us on our timetable, we wouldn't have an appreciation for Him, and we wouldn't grow in our faith. And so here Caleb, as he's standing there, he said, I'm 85 years old, and here I am this day. He was just basking in the glory of God and what he was doing in his life. Look at verse 11. As yet, I am as strong this day as on the day that Moses sent me. Just as my strength was then, so now is my strength for war, both for going out and for coming in. Now, he's standing there. Not only did he get to see that, he says, I'm just as strong as I was 40 years ago. I have the same amount of strength to go out and fight battles and win wars that I had back then. There's probably not many of us that can claim that we're as strong as we were 40 years ago. But here, God had allowed him to maintain his physical strength all of that time. And there's a reason for it. The reason was because he was going to need it. There's nothing that God's going to lead us to that he's not going to give us the strength to get through it. There's nothing that a circumstance that he's not going to walk us through that he's not going to give us everything we need to get through it and to get to the other side. His strength is perfect. His strength is unfathomable. And we, when we're sold out wholly to Him, we lean on His strength. Because there are things in my life I can't do, but God can. There's things that I can't do in my own strength, but He can. And Caleb had figured that out. And so here he's standing there. He's saying, I'm just as strong at 85 as I was at 40. Wow. What an incredible gift or blessing from God. But God knew He had something for him, and He was going to equip him with everything he needed. He still does. You see a challenge in front of you that God said He's going to deliver you from, He's going to give you all the strength that you need to endure it. And sometimes the enemy tries to come in and put fear in our life or put doubt in our lives. Like, I can't get through this. This circumstance, losing this loved one's too tough. You know, losing my job is too hard. These things are too hard. I can't endure it. Let me tell you what, God's grace is sufficient, and He can give you all the strength that you need in that perfect time. He will see you through to the other side. And so Caleb here, he's just basking in it. And so in verse 12, here he is, 85 years old, still strong as an ox. He knows that God has brought him to this point. And in verse 12, he says, now, therefore, give me this mountain. I love that. He boldly declared to Joshua, the leader of Israel, give me this mountain. It's been promised to me. God is faithful to His word. Give me the mountain. Now, he understood that there was still some work to be done. But that mountain was very special. That mountain was a very special place because that mountain was the place where Sarah, Abraham's wife, had died. That mountain was the place not far from where Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob were buried in a tomb. That mountain has significant meaning for the children of God. And so that mountain was a very important part of Caleb's inheritance. And he knew it. And so he just declared of Joshua, you're not going to put this in with all the other land to be divided up. This mountain's mine. He said, give me this mountain. Give me this mountain. Look what he said. Of which the Lord spoke in that day. For you heard in that day how the Anakim were there. And that the cities were great and fortified. So this mountain had not been yet conquered by the enemy in the mountain hadn't been conquered yet. And they were the Anakim. Who were they? They were a land of giants. They were giant people. There are a lot of theologians that believe they were part of the Nephilim, that they were part of a breed or a culture of giants demons had relations with women, and the result were these civilizations or these cultures of giants. They were men of renown. The Bible refers to them as men of renown. How they were great warriors. They were huge, physically huge men, Goliath-type individuals. So when Caleb's saying, give me this mountain, he knows that it's filled with giants. He knows that it's filled with armies and with cities, fortified cities, that are still going to need to be conquered. He wasn't asking for the little peaceful valley that was already conquered and prepared. Caleb knew that there was a challenge ahead. Caleb knew that it was going to be difficult to run them out of the land. But Caleb knew that his God was able. Caleb knew that his God was able, so he said, give me this land. It's filled with the Amalekite. Their cities are great. They're well fortified. And then we see his heart in the next part of the verse. The Bible says, it may be that the Lord will be with me. Some translations just say, you know, if the Lord is with me, this is Caleb speaking, if the Lord is with me. I love that he said, it may be that the Lord is with me. The Lord had been with him up to this point. You know why? Because he had been with the Lord up to that point. Caleb had made a decision when he was a young man that he was going to wholly follow after God with everything that he had. That he was all in serving the Lord. That he was going to take God at his word. He was going to believe his promises. He was not going to let the enemy interfere. He was not going to give in to the fear that the enemy tries to use. He was not going to let the obstacles stand in his way. He was going to have that mountain because God had promised it to him, and he believed God. He took God at his word. Reminds me of somebody else in the Bible. The Bible says that Abraham believed God, and it was credited to him as righteousness. So in this moment, Caleb was just following the example of some of the faithful men of Israel from his past. He stood there and he said, give me this mountain. I know it's full of giants. I know it's got these cities. I know they have fortified walls, but you know what? My God is bigger than the Amalekites. My God is bigger than they are. My God can do exceedingly abundantly. He said, give me this mountain. And there are some of us that need to go claim some mountains in our own life. We've allowed Satan to convince us that that's not what God has for us. We've allowed Satan to convince us that maybe this just isn't going to happen. Maybe that relationship with that individual is just not going to be mended. Maybe this financial crisis that I'm walking through is not going to get any better. And we get lulled into complacency. Not Caleb. Not Caleb. He stood there and said, give me this mountain. It's a wreck. There's a lot of work to be done. But you know what? My God is able. And I begin to think that's the way we should live our lives. We should look at the things and the challenges in our lives as just obstacles for God to overcome. You know, he knew they were there, but it never hindered him from moving forward for the kingdom. It never hindered him from moving forward from claiming the promises that God had for him. You think about all the promises that God's made to each of us as a child of God. He says we're never going to be alone. He says that we don't have to be anxious for anything. He says he's going to supply our every need according to his riches and glory. You can just go on and on and on, and that he's safely going to see us to the other side. We have incredible promises made available to us, but yet we allow the enemy to convince us that it's never going to happen. But not Caleb. Not Caleb. He didn't see those obstacles as things that he was going to have to face. He saw them as things that God was going to overcome. He had that much faith in who his God is. We should too. He said, it's fortified cities. All these things are going to have to take place. He knew that there was still going to need to be some conquering done. You know, my Bible says that I am more than a conqueror in Christ Jesus. You know, the Bible says that I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. We put those on bumper stickers and we have that scripture in our wall. But man, it's time that the church begins to believe it. It's time that we begin to sell out for the kingdom and know that our God is able. That we become a people that are so committed to what God is doing that we don't worry about what he's not doing. We need to be on the same page as him moving forward and know that he's going to bring it all to completion. He's going to bring it all to fruition in his perfect time. No, he doesn't operate on my timetable. I've tried to convince him for years too. I haven't been successful. There's times it's like, God, you know, would you heal this person? Lord, they're suffering. Would you heal this individual? And he said, not yet. He said, I still got some things I'm working out for my glory in this situation. And you just need to trust me. You just need to trust me. I got a reminder of that today. There are some individuals that we've been praying for that are unchurched, unsaved, and as a result of a tragic situation that they're walking through, they got up and are going to church this morning. Amen. Hallelujah. You know, that they're beginning to see their need for God in the midst of something that's hard. It's easy to turn away from God when things are easy. It's hard to turn to him when things are going our way. You know, but in that moment, when we begin to embrace the hardships and know that they're just opportunities for God to shine, that's what Caleb's doing, then that begins to bring a confidence in our heart, and it begins to bring joy in our heart, and we can have peace no matter what's going on around us. We can look at that mountain in front of us and say, you know what, I'm going to the top because God promised me that I am, and I'm not going to let the enemy or anything get in my way. I'm going to wholly trust God, and it's going to work out all right. We have to understand that the things in this world aren't our timetable. They're not going to work out the way we want. I'm glad they don't. I want the things in my life to work out the way that He wants them to. I want the things in my life to be a reflection of Him in me and the power of God to be shown through me and in my life. To where everything that happens, people can just look and go, wow, look what God did. Look what God did. Because if I try to do them in my own strength, I will fail miserably. Caleb knew that if he tried to go up that mountain and claim it from the Anakim by himself, he was going to fail miserably. But he knew that victory was guaranteed because God had told him it would be if he went in the power and the strength of Almighty God. That is the same for every situation that you're battling and dealing with in your life today. Maybe it's grief. Maybe it's sorrow. Maybe it's finances. Maybe it's relationship. I don't know what you're dealing with. But I can tell you that God does, and He's able. If you will just trust Him, claim His promises, and move forward wholly committed to Him, He will provide it in His perfect time. He promises that He will. So look at Caleb, look at the response. Can you imagine Joshua? After that kind of argument, what else are you going to say? No, Caleb, I think we're just going to throw this in with the rest of the land. Even though you've told me God promised it to you, He's kept you alive. You're actually my elder. You're older than me. And He's delivered us, so... Look at what he says. In verse 13, the Bible says, "And Joshua blessed him and gave Hebron to Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, as an inheritance." Joshua said, "Okay." He blessed him. He said, "God bless you, brother, for what you're doing. God bless you for what you've been through, and God bless you for what you're about to do for the glory of God." He blessed him. He said, "It'll be an inheritance for your children." You think about that. There is no greater inheritance that we can leave our children than a godly legacy. There is no greater thing that we can leave for our children and our grandchildren than a legacy of godliness, of servitude for the kingdom, of peace and calm, for them to see that we trust God with our lives. And as a result of that, Caleb was about to inherit the mountain that God had promised him because of his faithfulness and because of the faithfulness of God. He said that, yep, you got it. He blessed him and gave it to him. Hebron, therefore, in verse 14, became the inheritance of Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, the Kenizzite, to this day. And I circled this in my Bible. Because he wholly followed the Lord God of Israel. You want to know the reason Caleb inherited the mountain? That he got what God had promised him? It's because he wholly followed after God. Friends, we live in a time where lip service is cheap. We live in a time where there are a lot of people that profess to be followers of Jesus Christ. Let me tell you, it's time for our actions to match our talk. We live in some dark days. This world is absolutely crazy. And I think that's a massive understatement. It's falling apart at the seams. But let me tell you what, God is still on His throne. And He still wants His children to trust Him in all things. He still wants to bless His people for their obedience. He still wants to do incredible things for our families. He still wants to bring a blessing to us. He still wants to display His glory through us to the world. But we have to be wholly surrendered to Him. The time for half-hearted Christianity is over. I don't know if you've read the news lately, but we're headed to a very dark place. But let me tell you what, the Bible says that Jesus is the light of the world. That there is still hope found in no other name but Jesus Christ. And that's who we serve. That's who we follow. That's who we chase after. And when we are wholly committed to that, the enemy has no place in our life. Satan can't stand it. He was so mad at Caleb he couldn't stand it. He sent everything he had to try to upend what Caleb was doing. But yet here in this moment, he said, okay, land of giants that are believed to be demonically influenced. Caleb was fighting physical battles and spiritual battles on his way to the top of the mountain. We are too. We have to understand that the battles that we fight not against flesh and blood, but against principalities of the spirits of darkness and wickedness in the heavenly places. That's what we're up against. But look at how God delivered Caleb. He said that because he wholly followed God, he inherited it. And then look at verse 15. And the name of Hebron formerly was Kirjath Arba. Arba was the greatest man among the Anakim. They had named the city, the star capital city of this land on this mountain, after one of the greatest military leaders of the Anakim. He would have been known worldwide for how vicious and how mighty he was in war. That's the mountain that Caleb was going to claim. That's the mountain that God had given him. It wasn't some little task. It was a monumental undertaking that Caleb was about to go through. He claimed the mountain. He still had to conquer the mountain. And he was able to do it by the power of God. He said that it was named after this. And he was the greatest man among the Anakim. And then the last part of the verse says, then the land had rest from war. I want you to think about that for a minute. The land had rest from war. The entire time the Anakim had the mountain, they were continually at war because they were fighting everybody. But in that moment, when Caleb came in, when he inherited the land, the Bible says that it had rest from war. Caleb was victorious. Caleb defeated the Anakites. He defeated them all soundly, so much so that they changed the name of the city. That it was now Hebron. It was no longer named after this pagan military leader, because the power of God, he overcame. Because by the power of God, he defeated him. And the Bible says that there was rest in the land. There was peace. So I began to think about what happens once God delivers us and we get to the top of the mountain. There's the answer. There's peace. There's the answer. It says that the land had rest from war. There was peace in the land. There was peace now. And so Caleb, as he took this mountain, as he went in and he drove them out, as he continued conquering, at 85 years old, he's still defeating the enemies of God by the power of God. And as he's doing so, he gets to the end, he takes the mountain, and the Bible says that there's rest from war, there's peace. That's the same thing that can happen in each and every one of our lives. That is the same thing that God wants to do for you and me. When we get to the point where we're in the middle of the battle, when we're in the middle of the struggle, we're wholly serving God, we're sold out to Him, and we begin to trust Him fully, when He gets us to the top of the mountain, when He delivers on His promises, there will be peace. There will be peace in your life. There will be peace in your family. There will be peace in your finances. There will be peace in this nation. There will be peace in the world. You want world peace? Everyone needs to wholly chase after God, because He's the only one that can deliver it. And then there's going to be eternal peace when we end up in glory with Him. And so Caleb knew that. He spent his entire life wandering around with a bunch of people that doubted what God could do, but not him. Not him. He chose to live differently. He and Joshua chose to believe God. And as a result of that, the end result was Caleb had peace. Caleb got to live in a place where there was no more war. The conflict was over. I kept thinking about the song. It is finished. The battle is over. It is finished. There'll be no more war. It's what Jesus declared from the cross. And so here Caleb was just walking and basking in the peace of God, because he had been wholly faithful to God in everything he did. We need to get back to doing that, church. We need to be people that are so sold out to God, that we're so in tune with His will, that it doesn't matter what the enemy throws at us. Do you think it was difficult for Caleb to climb the mountain? Absolutely. He had to go fight the giants. He still had to go conquer the cities. There was still some work to do. He claimed it, but then he had to conquer it. He still had to conquer. There's still things in my life that I'm having to conquer, that I'm having to overcome by the power of God. But you know what? One day I'm going to be victorious in those things, because I'm trusting God with them. I don't trust me anymore. I let myself down all the time. I disappoint myself on a regular basis. But you know what? God has never failed me. God has never failed me. He has always been there. He has always been able to come along and to encourage and to pick me up and to keep me in line. Woo, man, I need Him. Because I, you know, all of us have sinned. We're all stray from God at times. But we need to fine tune. We need to get our lives to the point that we're wholly chasing after Him. You know, when people ask, what's the most important thing in your life? Oh, it is my relationship with Jesus Christ, period. That's the most important thing in my life. And when I do that, guess what? My relationship with my wife's going to be what it should be. My relationship with my children is going to be what it should be. My relationship with my friends, with my church family, with everyone is going to be exactly what it should be, because my relationship with Jesus is where it needs to be. We need to take the heart and the attitude of Caleb. If y'all didn't realize or notice, I named my son Caleb for this reason. And if you look at the Hebrew translation of the name, It actually means raging canine madness. Okay. That gives you an idea of the heart and the mindset of Caleb. He lived up to his name because he was a vicious, like a rabid dog for the kingdom of God. He didn't let anything stop him. He walked in, he saw these giants in the land, and he went, "Whoo, that's nothing. We can take them. We can take them by the power of God." That's the kind of attitude we need to have. That's the kind of boldness we need to have. That's the kind of courage that we need to have to stand in the days that we're living in today. And we can do it. Has God changed? Nope. Have his promises changed? Mm-mm. Will they ever? Not for a minute. All the things that God promises and wants to do in the lives of each and every one of us, he will bring to completion if we will wholly chase after him. Because when we do, then he is able to go to work. We get out of the way. As we were praying before we began our service this morning, I prayed, "Lord, get us out of the way. Get me out of the way so that you can shine. It's not about me. It's about him." Caleb was standing there in complete and utter humility. He was a very humble man. He brought the leaders of Judah with him so that they knew that they were in agreement with what he was asking Joshua. And so they came as a support for him because they knew that what Caleb was doing was promised and had been laid out by Almighty God. We have a great support system here at Sardis Baptist Church. We have people that encourage each other. We pray for each other. We do everything we can to meet the needs of each other. And that's a beautiful thing. There's some places that's not the case. And God, I know in my spirit God's about to do something mighty in our presence. We're about to have some Caleb climbing mountain moments here by the power of God. Because I just see him at work in so many lives. And I see the victories. You know, I see the victories. I see people overcoming things that they've struggled with for years. I see that beginning to take place by the power of God. And that can happen when we get out of the way. It's all Caleb did. He got out of the way. He believed God. And as a result of that, he got to stand on top of the mountain and had peace. That's my prayer for each and every one of us, that we'll experience that peace that comes from being sold out to God. When we know that he's got everything under control, it doesn't matter what Washington does. It doesn't matter what the World Economic Forum does. It doesn't matter what anyone does. God is in control, and he always will be. And when we wholly are sold out to him, we will get to walk in peace. We're still going to get to battle for his glory. We're still going to conquer for his glory. And at the end, we're going to be in perfect peace for all eternity because he has already won the war. Heavenly Father, I just come to you this morning in the name of Jesus. I thank you for your word. I thank you for Caleb and his faithful example to wholly follow after and chase after you in everything. And God, I thank you for fulfilling your promise to him. I thank you for allowing him to be victorious, Father, and to stand on top of the mountain that you had for him, Father. And God, I just pray that each one of us, everyone under the sound of my voice, God, will know you as Lord and Savior and will be wholly committed to following you. And God, to know that the things we battle with in this life are temporary. And God, that you're able. You give us all the strength we need. It doesn't matter how young we are, how old we are, Father. You are the Ancient of Days, Father, and you can give strength when it's needed at just the right time and in just the right measure. So God, we just surrender every part of our lives to you and just ask you to bless us, Father. And God, we trust you in all things. We believe you to keep your promises. Father, I pray if there's someone here that has never been born again, they've never put their faith and their trust in Jesus Christ, they will never be able to wholly follow after you and receive the promises that you have. I pray today would be the day that they repent and believe the glorious gospel of Jesus Christ. Father, I pray for each of my brothers and sisters in Christ that are hearing this today, that will hear or watch this today. Father, I pray that we will have a renewed commitment in our spirit to seek after you, to chase after you. Father, our families are worth it. Our friends are worth it. Our churches are worth it. Our nation is worth it, Father, for us to put ourselves aside and to be bold and courageous for the kingdom of God. So, God, I just pray that you will give us the strength that we need to claim your promises. And, God, we just thank you that one day you've promised, if we'll do so, that we'll stand on top of the mountain. We'll bask in your presence and we'll have peace. So, Father, I just pray that you will give us everything we need until that day. God, use us for your glory. God, be in this invitation. It's all for you. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Would you stand? We're going to sing hymn number 305, Jesus Paid It All. He made a way so that we can get to the top of the mountain. You respond as we sing. Church this morning.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you for being here. Let's go out there this week and climb the mountain. The Lord is able to give you the strength that you need for each day. Look forward to seeing you back next week. Bring a friend. I'm just so excited about what God's doing. Heavenly Father, thank you for letting us be in your house today. Thank you for your word. Thank you for lives, Father, that you can change by the power of the gospel. God, I just pray for each of those here, Lord, that we will go out and take the good news of Jesus Christ out into a dark and dying world, that you will give us the strength that we need in the moment, Father, and that we will be unafraid, that we'll be bold, and we'll be courageous for the kingdom of God. God, I pray for those that couldn't be here today because they're battling health concerns. They have loved ones that are hurting. They have loved ones that you called home, Father. God, I just pray that you will mend the brokenhearted, Father. You promise that you will. And God, that you'll just bring us all back safely. Give us a blessed week, Father, chasing after holy serving you in all things. And we will give you the glory for it all. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
And go in peace.